Good morning, everyone. I'm Pat Martel. I'm the president of the ICMA Executive Board, and it is my real pleasure to welcome all of you today to this special session of our regional summit program. It's a little bit different than things that we have been doing for a while, in that we wanted to capitalize on the fact that we had our Young Professionals Institute here and engage some of our young professionals, many of whom are women, in a very interesting sort of view of the profession from some women that I know that when you hear about them today and hear their stories are going to be completely inspiring role models to you. They were to me when I first got introduced to them, and they have a lot to share about how they took on non-traditional positions in local government and how they grew as leaders. And as I was just talking with one of them earlier, none of them grew up thinking that they were going to do what they actually do today. And that's going to be one of the really important lessons in the conversation today, because when we talk about leadership, leadership is a process. You're not born a leader, you evolve into becoming a leader, and everyone can do it. And so the title of our program, that you've got what it takes to be a resilient leader, is very, very important for all of us to recognize, even those who are here today who are seasoned managers and leaders, because throughout our careers, that leadership journey that we are involved in, it changes. There's ebbs and flows. There are great high points in your leadership career, and there can often be very low points. And it's the resiliency with which you deal with those changes in your leadership process that we're going to talk about, and how you can push yourself through challenging moments, how you can really get to the other side of what can sometimes be disappointing experiences, failures. And we don't like to talk about failures, but failure is a reality in everything that we do. It's how you deal with failure that makes the difference with a resilient leader. So today, we have a terrific panel that's going to talk about how they worked through challenges and how they got to the point where they were able to take on positions that for most of us, we would never dream of taking on. And particularly in environments where, as many of us know, and some of you who have heard me speak before, know that I myself acknowledge that when I started out in this profession 35 years ago, the world was very different. The world in local government was primarily middle-aged white men who led our organizations, all good men. Some of my best mentors were those middle-aged white men. I learned a lot from them. But to think back at that time, and what I'm looking at in the audience today, the world has changed. It's really changed in local government, the way that it's changed in society, in our communities. And resilient leadership is about knowing how to deal with those changes, being prepared for change, having to move on a dime because something has happened in your organization or to you personally in your career, and you've got to deal with that and keep going, keep motivated through that process. And that's what resiliency is all about. Part of leading is learning about how to challenge yourself. And so you're going to hear a little bit today from each of our panelists about how they've challenged themselves, how they have pushed themselves through beyond their comfort zone. Leadership requires that of all of us. You can't be complacent. You can't say, oh, I'm only going to do the things that are easy, that I know about, that I feel good about and comfortable about. When you feel that way, you're not taking the leadership challenge. You're not pushing yourself beyond that into that zone where you feel scared sometimes. Because being scared is what helps to propel us as leaders. It helps us to build the skills that are necessary to be effective leaders. So I'm going to give you a little introduction of our panelists today. And then we're going to have a conversation for the next half hour, 40 minutes around leadership. And then following that, we're going to have some small group conversations. And at that time, the panelists and I are going to rotate around the room to sort of listen about what you've heard from their conversations and to fill in some ideas about leadership. So one thing I'm going to ask you to be thinking about before we start those small group sessions at the end is I need one person from each table to be a facilitator for the conversation. So when we're done, I'm going to ask all of the individuals who want to be the facilitator to raise their hand. So please think about it. Take that leadership challenge I'm giving you and agree to be the facilitator. It'll be easy. We've got some questions already ready for you to ask. And your job is just to facilitate the conversation and then to report out a couple of the highlights from those group discussions. So without any further delay, I'm going to introduce our panelists, and they are terrific. So immediately to my left is Fire Chief Toni Washington. Toni is the Fire Chief of Decatur, Georgia. She became Fire Chief in January of 2009. And the incredible part about her and her journey is that she was the first in many ways. She was the first woman chief of the Decatur Fire Department, and obviously she was the first African-American woman in that fire department. Those are two huge hurdles for anyone in fire service. I can tell you that. I've had managed fire departments my entire career. So to be able to take on that role is really an amazing leadership success for Toni. She began a public safety career at the State Fire Marshal's Office, and then she moved to a Metro Atlanta Fire Department, where she began to work in the position of Deputy Fire Chief. Toni attended Savannah State University, where she received her Bachelor of Business Administration in Marketing and Management. She's expanded her education and received her Master of Science in Managerial Leadership from National Louis University. And she's also attended the Carl Holmes Executive Development Institute at Dillard University, the National Fire Academy, and has received her officer designation from the Center for Public Safety. Toni is Ashley Jacobs, who is the Executive Director of the Lake City Community Development Department, or Office of Lake City, South Carolina. She's been in that position since September of last year. And prior to that, she was an assistant or deputy county manager. She has overseen a number of positions as deputy administrator for Dorchester County in South Carolina for 9 years. And before that, she worked for Richland County, South Carolina for about 5 years as the assistant to the county administrator. And then over at my far left, we have Jill Scruggs Silverboard, who is the assistant city manager of Clearwater, Florida. She's a native of North Carolina, but she's lived in Florida for more than 26 years. She has a Master's of Public Affairs from Western Carolina University and a Bachelor of Arts from Lenoir Rhyne in North Carolina. You can tell I'm from the West Coast. She has more than 28 years of experience in local government administration and is a longtime member of ICMA. She became the Assistant City Manager at Clearwater in 2007. Prior to joining Clearwater, she served as a city manager in Madeira Beach and in Destin, Florida. So she has been a city manager as well. And she spent 8 years as deputy city manager in both Destin and Hallandale Beach, Florida. So we're going to start out by having the panelists briefly fill in some of the details that I haven't given you. They're going to share a little bit about their career journeys and how they got from where they started that journey to today. So Toni, why don't you start with
it? Great. So we talk about challenges all the time, and I think one of the largest challenges that I have that I still struggle with today is speaking about myself. So bear with me. If I'm up here and I start hyperventilating, just ignore me, I'll get over it. So I really stumbled into the fire service career. Coming out of college, I wasn't really sure what I wanted to do because I did an internship with a tobacco company, and I was like, yeah, I don't think that's what I want to do. So going back home to my mom, I said, okay, what am I going to do? So I started with the State Fire Marshal's Office in the early 90s. And during that time, fire departments were heavily recruiting women. So I was hired of one of seven women as the first in the city of East Point, which for me, going into that, I was like, okay, did absolutely no background work, had no idea what I was really about to encounter. I'm going in there all happy, ready to go, and they're looking at me like, what is she doing here? So I'll back up and give you a little bit of statistics so you can get an understanding of why it was so challenging. There are over 300,000 firefighters in the U.S. Of the 300,000, there are only 7,000 women. Of that 7,000, there are only 100 chiefs, and that's battalion chief, deputy chief, anything with chief in. And of that, there are less than 30 fire chiefs. And from that, right now, it's only two African-American fire chiefs in the U.S. right now. So, you know, when I got into the fire service, I had no idea. I didn't realize all the obstacles and the barriers that I would face throughout my journey. You know, I was really naive. I say that all the time because, you know, coming in, they lost our applications. The spouses had meetings to keep us out. The guys, you know, they really endured a lot also because they had to go through sexual harassment training, and they were terrified of us coming into the fire service. So, you know, I walk in, hey, how you doing? You know, smiling. And they look at me and turn their heads because they were really scared to talk to us. So, you know, going through all of that and just not really understanding, and coming from a family of one of eight, I have eight siblings, you know, it was always a challenge and a push for us to do good, be the best, be on top. So I looked at it not as an obstacle, but as a challenge, and I knew that I was going to move forward and I was going to be the best at what I could do. Okay, so throughout my career, I was like, okay, I have education. You know, I have to get more education behind me. So I got my master's while I was in the fire service in the station, and there I faced a lot of challenges because, you're getting a master's to ride on a fire truck? Really? Are you crazy? Little did they know that. You know, I had no idea I was going to be on the fire truck that long. I thought I was going to go through recruit school and then go directly to the office and, you know, have a desk job. I had no idea I was going to have to work my way up, and it would take me years to get there. So so I had goals for myself. So, you know, it all began there. And from there, as we talk more, you'll see, you know, things progress. And, you know, I'm in the city of Decatur now, and even getting that job was really a defining moment for me. And, you know, we talk about bubbles all the time, and I really feel like, you know, I'm in a bubble in the city of Decatur. And Decatur is greater, and I really feel like that. It's great. It's when I step outside of Decatur and I say, uh-oh, here's reality. So it's been awesome. It really has been an awesome journey for me. A lot of barriers, a lot of challenges, but I was able to overcome them with, you know, some support, a lot of good leadership, you know, especially where I am now. You know, a lot of you know, my bosses, and, you know, they encourage us, they mentor us, they promote us. So, you know, it's been awesome, and, you know, I try not to look back at the barriers and the challenges and the bad things. I like to look at what's going on now and move forward. So that has really been my focus, because sometimes if you hold on to those negative things, they hold you down and they prevent you from moving forward. So,
well, thank you for sharing that, Toni. So, Ashley, you started out more in a traditional sort of local government management in terms of working in a county and sort of moving But then you've switched jobs.
Well, so no, not really, Pat. Let me say that. Because my path to local government was a winding and frigging trail. And sorry to surprise you. This will be fun. So when I graduated from Clemson, I had an English major, a technical writing minor, had absolutely no idea what I wanted to do in my life. I'd gone backpacking in New Mexico my senior year for spring break, and met a gentleman who owned a ranch. And he said, would you like to come work on the ranch? And I said, yes. I don't want a desk job when I graduate. I want to go, work in the, work out in the open in New Mexico. It's so beautiful here. So upon graduating from Clemson, I moved to New Mexico and worked on this ranch. And, did everything from cleaning stalls to cooking to fixing fences, all kinds of things like that. And then after about 6 months of that, I realized that, maybe I should do something with my degree. I had an education in addition. So I met a number of people in Santa Fe who said, well, Boston needs technical writers, and you have that skill. Why don't you move to Boston? So I said, yeah, that sounds like an adventure. So I got in my car and drove to Boston. Knew no one there. I actually lived in my car for a few days until I got a job as a cab driver. And I drove a cab in Boston for about 6 months.
These are all details she left out of the bio. Particularly the part about being a cowgirl. Yeah.
Well, I think it's, and I tell you these things because they served me later in my career. They actually turned out to be very valuable experiences. And at the time, I felt like I was just wandering, aimlessly. But they did end up serving me a purpose. So I drove the cab for a while. But then I met the Boston Women's Networking Group, and they found me a job in technical writing. So I did work as a technical writer for about 4 years in Boston. But when I was there, I was still feeling really unfulfilled in that job, and feeling like, what do I want to do with my life? And so I started taking classes at Boston University about public administration. I can't even remember what drew me to those classes, but that's what I started taking. And I had a wonderful professor who did a great job of explaining how public administration serves people, and how working in local government results in healthy communities and safe communities. And so that was very appealing to me. I thought, okay, this is it. This is what I want to do. I can make a difference. I can, do something wonderful in this career. So I love Boston, and came back home to South Carolina, and went to grad school at University of South Carolina. And when I was working there, I started working for Central Midlands Council of Governments, which is a metropolitan planning agency, and I worked as a planner there. So I did transportation and water quality planning, and I also coordinated a program with the U.S. Department of Energy program called Clean Cities, which promoted the use of alternative fuels. You see, yes, few of you nodding your heads that are familiar with that. I was really passionate about it. I really loved that program. I felt like it was a great thing for the environment, but also felt like it was very important for national security. So I felt really, really passionate about it. I was very involved with it, did a lot of public speaking, actually had a piece of legislation passed that provided some incentives to use alternative fuel. It didn't catch on for a number of reasons. Mainly, the problem with alternative fuel is infrastructure. But being so passionate in that role and being so engaged in the community, I became close with the Richland County Administrator, who recruited me there to be the assistant to the county administrator. And there I supervised the sort of special projects. And then after a couple of years, I was promoted to assistant county administrator. And there I supervised community development, economic development, utilities, building services, and planning. Then I took a job in Dorchester County and was there for 9 years and served as deputy administrator. And in that role, when I started, I was deputy administrator for administrative services. So I had budget and finance, human resources, fleet services, information technology, risk management, and basically all the internal services. The county, as you may know, I don't know if you're familiar with where Dorchester is located, but it's adjacent to Charleston. And I'm sure you know Charleston is experiencing tremendous growth, has been for the past 10 years, just crazy growth. And we felt that as well. And as a result of that growth, we reorganized. So I then took on a new group of departments, which we call community services. So I took on fire, my favorite, EMS, emergency management,
Animal Control, Building Services, and Planning and Zoning. And then in September this past year, I made a tremendous career change and moved to the Greater Lake City Community Development Office. And in this role, what I'm basically doing is rebuilding the economy of Lake City. It's a town of about 7,000 people that's about 30 minutes south of Florence, so it's completely isolated in the middle of nowhere and very small. But it has something going for it. There is a billionaire who is from Lake City named Darla Moore, and she actually funds our office, and that's who I work for. Well, I'm technically an employee of the city of Lake City, so I report to the mayor and the city council and Darla and my board. So it's really easy. But anyway, that's where I am now.
Great. So you see, journeys do take a lot of twists and turns in the road. And even when you think you've hit the job that you want in a county administrator's office, things change. So tell us about your journey, Jill.
Well, I knew from the time I was a sophomore in college that I wanted to work in local government. So I'm a little different than these folks. I had a plan. And as we all know, the first casualty of the plan is the plan, right? So, but it was going well for a while. I mean, I really thought I, you know, had it all together. And my emphasis in grad school was actually in urban planning. And so I was employed in my first real job. I had worked for a couple of municipalities. I interned and had been employed actually in my hometown up in Western North Carolina, and I was selected to serve as the planning director for Brevard in Transylvania County, North Carolina. And so I thought that was it. I planned to stay there. I had no intention of going anywhere else. That's, you know, right over the mountain where I'm from. So it was, I thought, the ideal. This is where I'm going to be, and I'm going to be a planning director. That lasted a couple of years, and due to a personal choice, I ended up in Dade County, Florida, Miami. And so not only did I have a huge cultural shift to adapt to and learn, I had the good fortune, though, of getting a job with the city of Hallandale Beach, Florida, in the planning department. Actually, they called it community development, I think, something like that. So I went to work for Hallandale, and very quickly, within 2 years, was actually the director for community development and building, permitting, zoning, code enforcement, all that stuff. So I had been promoted fairly quickly. And again, I'm going to be a planner. This is what I'm going to do. I had gotten my AICP. You know, this is my passion. This is what I want to do. The deputy city manager left the organization to go be a city manager, and so I was brought down to the manager's office to fill in, and that was like 1993, I think. So I got to the manager's office and I'm like, this is really cool. This is great. You don't get yelled at as much as you do when you're in planning. It's kind of nice, you know. Not have to work the zoning counter anymore. So great opportunity, great boss. I think that was probably about the time I met Lee Feldman. So, you know, everything from that point forward I owe to Lee. Actually, Lee was he was an assistant city manager in a neighboring community. So that's how long we've known each other. But so I worked there for, 8 years, long time, as the assistant city manager, and then I became the deputy. And I was like, this is great. This is good. I like it. I'm happy. All is well. I'm going to, you know, move on. Due to yet another personal situation, I ended up moving to Destin, up in the panhandle of Florida, as their deputy city manager. And not unlike what Toni was describing, you know, what you think something is and what the reality is, we're very different. But nonetheless, being kind of fearless and trying to be as adaptable as I could, had outdated technology and big list of things to fix, so it was kind of nice. I worked there for about 4 months, and they fired the city manager one night out of the blue. We all know what that's like. And so I just kind of moved over into the chair and, okay, kept going. So I was the interim city manager, and they wanted me to take the job as city manager, but I was at a point where I wanted to have children. And so I declined, didn't take the promotion, ended up spending the next 2.5 years serving, continuing to serve as the deputy, but in a pretty tumultuous circumstance. The manager had very poor relations with a couple of council members, including the mayor, and it was a pretty rough time. But I did actually have children during that time. And then he went on vacation, my city manager went on vacation, and they fired him. So I moved over into the chair, and I said, this time, you know what, I'm gonna do it. This is crazy, you know, I can do this. This is what I can do. So all that sort of precedes my crucible moment, but I won't say any more about that right now, other than to let you know that part of why my situation has been such a bizarre path is I'm married to a city manager. So the decision to go to Destin was related to him, and the decision of my crucible moment, which took us to Georgia for 11 months and then back to Florida, related to him. So my story is really about having to try and balance my career with my spouse's career, which career we were gonna follow, which was gonna be the lead, and that has changed over the years. He's quite a few years older than me. So we found ourselves unemployed with 2-year-old twin daughters in Carrollton, Georgia. I was not even getting interviews for assistant city manager positions in Georgia anywhere, because we had hoped to stay in Georgia. Well, I started applying in Florida, and it was like, oh, this is great. So took a job in Madeira Beach, Florida, which is, if you're not familiar, it's one of the beaches that's just west of St. Petersburg on the Gulf. Bizarre little place. They call it Mad Beach for a good reason. And interestingly, though, the Destin experience was very similar, because they both believed that they were the best fishing place in Florida, so a lot of synergy there. And I was there for 3+ long years. Very politically divided community, lots of challenges, lots of things. So again, primarily for more personal reasons, I applied for and was hired as assistant city manager in Clearwater, which is the position I continue to be in. We needed some stability. My husband was also in a crazy little beach town and as the manager. And so my journey has a little different twist to it because of that, but I'm very grateful for the experiences and was able to learn from each, build on each. So that's me.
Well, interestingly, what you've talked about around the transitions that you made, you kept referring to the politics that occurred, which so often in local government and public service, politics gets in the way of a lot of things. And it also is the precipitating event that makes people feel challenged, either around their values, their ethics, and leads to those crucible moments, those moments where you have to take a stand for something. And in taking that stand, it might work out really well for you, and it might work out really poorly for you. And all of us have had those kinds of experiences in our careers. So let's talk about that. So Ashley, tell us about a crucible experience that you had, something that was a real challenge that you had to work through that really made you take stock in who you are as a professional and what you were going to do in response. Okay.
When I started one of my county jobs, I had 6 department heads, and every single one of them was at least 20 years older than I was. And most of them had been in their positions as long as I've been alive. It was a rural county, very small county, and so everyone was related. Everyone was very well connected. In fact, I used to call it the family wreath rather than the family tree. But coming into that role, I'm glad you appreciate that. Coming into that role, I was an outsider. I wasn't from there. My county administrator was not from there. And
when I came in, you know, I was very Leslie Knope at that age. You know, I was like, guys, we're going to build a great county. It's going to be, you know, we're going to do all this, and we're going to do it. And I had my first staff meeting with them and was, you know, going through this with them, all the things we were going to do, all the great changes we were going to make. And they just sat there like this. And then they got up, they started getting up one by one and kind of walking out. And one of them came up to me and said, you don't belong this job because you're a woman. And women aren't good with numbers, and women are emotional, and women can't be leaders. So I don't know what you're doing here, but this is a mistake, and walks out. The next one comes up and says, I've seen administrators come and go, and you're gonna go in about 6 months, and I'm gonna be here forever. And walk out. That was the HR director.
Oh, nice.
Warm and fuzzy.
And then there were similar comments, you know, from the others, except for one who stayed behind and said, it's gonna be okay, we're gonna work through this. So I went back to my office and I was just in shock. You know, I was just totally stunned. First of all, I had never been, my gender had never been addressed in the workplace before, ever. I guess I'd been lucky, sheltered, I don't know, but it had never been really an issue before. I'd never had anyone tell me I couldn't do a job because of gender. So I was in total shock. And so I went back to my office and I went to my county administrator's office and I closed the door. And I said, let me tell you about the staff meeting I just had. And I told him, and he said, yeah, we're at war. And I thought, well, I thought two words, and the first one was holy. And I was like, what am I doing here? What have I got myself into? You know. And we were. We were at war with that, not only with that group of individuals, but many of the department heads. He supervised many of our elected officials. Who had been entrenched for so long, who had, as a result of that, you know, enjoyed tremendous power and influence over the organization and the community, and were not about to relinquish that power. And they didn't want to change the way that things were done. They weren't interested in progress. They were interested in maintaining their own personal power and control. But as you can imagine, with that being in place, the county was in a certain condition. You know, it wasn't professional, it wasn't operating the way that it needed to. And so we had a lot of work ahead of us. It took 6 years, but we managed all of those people out of the organization. And when I left, we had a totally new culture. We had new department heads who were professional and competent and who were leading the organization in the direction they needed to go. Was it worth it? Well, you know, it is a good feeling to leave a place better than how you found it. It definitely is. I'm glad that happened. It took a tremendous toll on my health. It had a lot, it resulted in a lot of personal upheaval, having to evaluate that whole situation. What am I doing here? Am I doing the right thing? Should I leave? You know, that kind of thing. But anyway, that was what I experienced.
Wow. So, Toni, I'm sure that throughout your career, as you've described it, you have probably been confronted with a clash of cultures on a lot of different levels with the different positions that you've had. So tell us about a crucible experience that you've had that made you take stock of where you were at the time and where you were going to go, and how did you get through that?
Sure. So I've had many, but one that stands out to this day is when I was first promoted to deputy fire chief. I had to do a presentation, give my expectations. So I had all the supervisors, and we were all in this in the training room. And I was just listing out some things and, you know, how we were going to do things. I was just smiling and, you know, they had all these looks like, okay, here she go, here she go. So then we get this call, we get this fire call, and we all have to rush out. So I'm like, oh my goodness, you know, I'm, you know, setting the stage, giving my expectations, and then all of a sudden I have to be pulled out and now deal with the fire scene as the leader. So I'm going to the fire scene, I go up, get out, I put my gear on. I didn't have to go in, so I'm a little slower, and my gear was white, so So I knew I wasn't going in to fight fire. So I get out and, you know, we have this family out and this guy is rushing up, running over. So, you know, my job was to deal with the families, deal with the media, kind of, you know, more of that stuff. So I go up to the resident, you know, he's frantic and he's like, oh, you know, our house is on fire and, you know, my dog is in there, all my belongings, you know, just really frantic. So I was like, well, sir, can I help you? You know, my name is, I'm the chief and, you know, I'm here to help you. He said, no, I need to speak to the real chief, not you. I was like, okay. I said, well, sir, you know, I am the supervisor here and, you know, let me help you, let me get some information. He said, I'm not gonna talk to you. So he proceeded to walk off from me and go to one of my subordinates. So really at that time, it really hit me and really struck a nerve with me. And even to this day, I get very emotional when I talk about it because, you know, again, I'm naive, you know. I hear about all the stories and I'm like, oh no, not in my world, you know. You know, all my life I've been, you know, faced with challenges with my brothers and sisters. It was a lot of us, and we were all in competition to be the first, and, you know. But for me, that moment, it was like, oh my goodness, you know, I can't believe in the 90s still people feel like this. So I had to kind of stand back and reassess. And I said, okay, am I gonna let this incident define who I am? Mm-hmm. Or am I gonna concentrate on focus on exactly why I'm here and move forward? So I didn't get into a confrontation with the resident. I just let him go on and speak with whoever he felt like he needed to speak with. And then we came back to the office after a few hours. And from there, I realized that I had a big road ahead of me and that I couldn't continue to ignore the realities of my career. I could not continue to be blind. I was not gonna let it define my destiny, but I couldn't continue to ignore it. So as we went on, of course, I had a lot of different experiences like that, not only with residents, but, you know, peers, which is not really, it's, I think dealing with the peers is probably worse than dealing with the residents. But, you know, even still to this day, and, you know, I just had to understand and keep moving because I found that when you hold on to the negativities, that it stunts your career. It stunts your growth. So I had to really let that go and move forward and just look ahead and deal with, you know, what I knew I needed to do to move forward and to get to the next level.
You know, those are important lessons when we talk about leadership and about resiliency because, you know, as the chief said, many different events that occur in our leadership journeys will affect us personally. And the ability to not take it personally and to allow that to define who you are, to let others define who you are, is what separates leaders, and particularly resilient leaders. Because resilient leaders know that no matter where you go, people are always different. They're all gonna have different perspectives. They're all gonna have opinions about you and about the things you do. But you can't allow others to define who you are. And a lot of it has to deal with the core of who we are and knowing what our values are, you know, staying close to those values and not compromising them. It's about belief in our ethics and not allowing other people to trample over our ethical values and what we think is right and wrong. That's what defines what real resilient leaders are all about. So Jill, tell us about your experience.
So the crucible moment that I want to share with you relates to what I said earlier about the Carrollton, Georgia experience. I wasn't the city manager. My husband had been hired as a city manager. And so I actually quit my job as the city manager in Destin, which I loved, and you know, having very good success there, building a great team. Felt like we were really moving forward. But for a lot of reasons, his time was up in Fort Walton Beach. We knew it. So it was time for us to make that next move. And so we moved to Carrollton, Georgia. He was hired as the city manager. The work lasted 4 months, and they fired him. Not because he wasn't performing. I mean, really, 4 months is not even enough time to get a sense of, you know, the person, or, you know, he hadn't done anything illegal or ethical, unethical. So my crucible was Red Clay and Kudzu in West Georgia, and the next year was probably the most challenging of all. We decided that I would be the lead career person going forward. I won't get into his story about the effect that that had on all of us, but it was devastating. And as I mentioned earlier, I couldn't get interviews. I wasn't even being asked to come and interview. I mean, I had 20-something years of experience as an assistant city manager and city manager, and I wasn't even being asked to come and interview. The only interview I had in Georgia was with the Greater Atlanta Home Builders Association, and I think it was because I was a curiosity. Like, why would you apply for this job? And so, you know, I'm feeling very concerned, of course, for the well-being of my family. I felt the responsibility shift, that it was not my husband anymore, it was me. So I ended up with two offers. One was in North Carolina, which is, you know, as you know, where I'm from. And I thought, oh, this is good, I can go back home. But that position really was in a location that didn't offer much for my husband. So we were really trying to be selective, find a place in Florida where we could both end up gainfully employed again. So that's how I ended up in Madeira Beach. When I got to Madeira Beach, they had just fired the last manager. They had just fired the city attorney. The employees had just decided to unionize. And emotions were high. It was, as I mentioned earlier, very politically volatile environment. I really think the only reason I was able to stay there 3+ years is because the makeup of the city commission kept changing. People would come and go, and so it was always a new mix. But despite all of that at the electeds level, I had a great team, really good directors. We had a strategy, we knew what we were working for, and really actually accomplished surprisingly good things that community is now realizing today. The recession kind of interrupted that a little bit. So for me, that's my story of resiliency, is going from, you know, the oh my God moment of having, you know, these young kids and my husband and I being unemployed and not being able to get interviews, and finally being able to secure something. Was it ideal? No, it wasn't ideal, but I needed a job. And I was able to adapt and really build a great team. Interestingly enough, my husband ended up in the neighboring community there. And between the two of us, we continued to employ all four of my department heads in Madeira Beach. One is with me in the city of Clearwater, and two are with him in Treasure Island, and then the fourth one actually is still in Madeira, but one of which was our fire chief. But we look back on that experience as a real low point. But you know, honestly, what are you going to do? I mean, you got to pull yourself up. You got to get out of bed in the morning. You got children to worry about and bills to pay. And so going back to Florida was a good decision for us. I really feel like the Madeira Beach experience was as tough as it was politically. I'm very proud of the work that I was able to accomplish there. And I think it really, quite frankly, set the stage for my next position in Clearwater, which has been fabulous in comparison to the earlier stuff. So
the important lesson out of what you've just heard from these three amazing women and the crucible experiences that they've had in their careers is that it didn't define them. They dealt with it and they moved on. And obviously, as you can tell from their current positions, it didn't affect their career path at all. You know, I myself had a crucible experience during my career. It had to do with politics, and it resulted in a transition from a really great job that I really loved a lot, and that I feel like I was really great at doing. But politics didn't work out because I wasn't willing to compromise my ethics and my values to do things that others wanted me to do, including the mayor. And it's those moments that we're reminded about who we are as individuals. And another important thing that I think is really important about resiliency in the leadership role is that when things happen, because bad things happen to really good people, it does. It's not just an adage, it's true. Bad things happen to good people, and good people can get through those bad things and move on to better things. But what is really important out of that is the fact that you don't define yourself by the role that you may have lost. You define yourself by the individual that you are, the values, the ethics that, you know, that drive you as a leader. Because at the end of the day, it's a job we do. It's not who we are as people. And I think that's the important lesson that we are reminded about when we get through crucible experiences and have the benefit of looking back, of retrospect, of gaining perspective. So let me ask this question of the three of you. When you got through that crucible experience, was that defining moment for you? Did you understand it right at that time, or was it something that over time, the lessons from that experience became clearer to you? Because I think sometimes it can be immediate, and sometimes you don't really see it until somewhere down the line, and then all of a sudden there's an aha moment. And you realize, this is what I learned from that experience. And I got through that one, and I'm going to get through this one the same way. So how did that happen for you, Jean?
Yes, it happened. I guess my aha moment really came later. Because when I dealt with that experience, I had no idea that it was preparing me for the future. And being one of a few female fire chiefs, when I got the job, in Decatur, I had vision. There were a lot of things that I wanted to do. I knew that there would be some challenges, but I guess my biggest challenge when I got the job wasn't necessarily the job, but it was the people. So I look back on my crucible moment and I look at how it has prepared me in dealing with conflict and to not immediately react, to go back, to digress and think about things and not just react to what's put before you so quick. Because sometimes when you have those reactions, it's not always the best reaction. Mm-hmm. It's that thing that my mom used to say, okay, take 5 minutes before you talk. You know? So looking back on that experience, that really prepared me for where I am now. And I talk about my biggest challenge as the fire chief 9 years ago was the people. And, you know, I felt like, you know, I've been through everything that all the firefighters have been through. I've proved myself because I've worked my way up to fire chief. But coming in from another municipality, being an outsider, was my largest challenge, just being accepted. And I don't feel like it was because they thought I couldn't do the job, but that I was an outsider. So it was some things that happened along the way that that I really looked back on my crucible moment and said, hey, you know, that happened, I dealt with that, and that was devastating. So I can definitely handle things going forward.
What about for you, Ashley? Did you know right at that moment, or over time, did it become clearer to you?
I think the aha moment came about a year ago when
when I was at a, we had a big department head meeting, and I was looking out across the crowd, and I realized that everyone that I had had a problem with, everyone who had been problematic when I first arrived on that job, was gone. Mm-hmm. I started looking around and thinking, okay, yep, that person's one of my favorite department heads. That person does a great job. That person is incredibly supportive. And just realizing that we had completely changed the culture. And I kind of felt at that moment like, I made it. I survived. I survived the personal attacks and the professional attacks. I survived the politics. I don't know how I did it, but I got through it. I'm here. I'm standing, you know. And what I learned from it, looking back on it, was that, first of all, self-care is the most important thing. When you're going through a crucible moment, when you're going through something that's just, you know, incredibly disruptive like that, self-care is the most critical part of survival. And whether that's, you know, your spiritual life, having people in, you know, having close connections with your family, your friends, colleagues, people who can advise you, basically having a way to comfort yourself, to protect yourself, is really important. Because what happened to me is that after that period of battling all of that for so long, my body was dealing with was chronic stress. And so I was 50 pounds overweight, I was diabetic, I had high blood pressure, and I was on thyroid medication. And, you know, my doctor said, you know, this is a result of chronic long-term stress. You know, that's why you're here now. So, and that had a big part in my decision to change jobs, actually, because I thought, you know, even though everything is calm now, everything is settled here, I've met my goals, but I think it's time to go on and try something that really is a better fit with my character and, you know, with my goals.
That's a really important point, you know, because self-awareness is very important during these kinds of experiences, of knowing what you can take and what you can't take, and being truthful to yourself about how you're going to deal with situations, and being able to say enough is enough. And sometimes, you know, particularly when you feel like you've reached that point in your career where you've got everything going for you, but it's not going well, and then being able to step back and get perspective and say, you know, I should feel like I have it all, but it's not working well for me. And I have to take care of me in order to be the best that I can be in whatever my job is. So having that self-awareness and over time continuing to be a reflective person about experiences that we go through is very important, so that whether you get the perspective immediately or the aha moment comes somewhere down the line, being self-reflective helps us to get that perspective that we need out of a difficult situation. So what about for you, Jill? How did you come to grips? What was the aha moment?
So I think actually a little of both. The first one was I should have never married another city manager. just kidding, actually. He's been a wonderful life partner, and how often do you get somebody who completely understands your job, right? So I think really though, for me, in the moment of the disaster, I'm just on autopilot, right? I'm just doing what I need to do to find myself a job and get the ship righted. And we all work with emergency management situations where, you know, you got to do what you got to do right then. So for me, it really kind of touches on what both Tanya and Ashley were saying about the resiliency side. Is I always prided myself on being so adaptable, because I was able to go from small town in Western North Carolina, working in a built out beach community in South Florida, and building relationships and having a great deal of career success, and then going from there to the Panhandle, which I thought would be like North Carolina, but it was nothing like North Carolina. But again, building, you know, relationships, and I always prided myself on that. My bigger aha moment has actually come in reflection the last couple of years, has really been, you know, there is something to be said for finding the right organization for where you are. And my hope is that even if you find yourself, as I often did, and having to just do what you had to do, that you can eventually be able to have the choice to be in an organization such as Tanya is and Ashley is now, where you're supported, you're built up, you have great working relationships within your organization, which I had all of that, but that was by force of energy on my part to make that happen. And it's a lot less effort when you're in the right place at the right time with the support. And one of the other things I just want to throw out there too that has been hugely important to me has been the professional support within the profession that I find not only in Florida as a whole, but also really right in my own backyard. You know, when I first arrived in Madeira Beach, there were two managers that reached out, put their arm around me, you're going to be great, you're going to be fine, it's all good, one of whom had actually worked in the community that I was going to. So, you know, I don't want to discount that either. Mm-hmm. And now that I'm in Clearwater and able to participate both at the state association level and the national, I'm trying to give back now because I think there is truth to this idea that nobody knows until you've actually sat in the chair. And that's one of the reasons I take such great comfort in being able to be surrounded with people who do what I do and get it. But I hope that at some point in your careers, you will be able to choose the right place for the right time. Clearwater wouldn't have been the right place for me, you know, 25 years ago. But it's definitely a good place for me to be right now.
So Jill, you raised a really important issue, and that is when you're going through these crucible moments, and even when you're not, when you're going through the good times, it's really important to establish, build relationships with others that you can rely on to get feedback from, both in good times or when you're facing a tough decision and you want some feedback about whether or not the course of action that you're sort of laying out is going to, you know, is viable or not, whatever the circumstances are. Building a network of people both in your organization, outside your organization, in the profession, outside of the profession, people that help to provide balance in your perspective that you can talk to and that will tell you the truth and that you value the input that they give you, that they might tell you, oh, you're headed, you know, to a brick wall, you better rethink this. Sometimes we need that input before it happens, right? But building relationships is very important to resiliency because we can't always rely just on ourselves for all the right answers. And particularly when you're in the midst of a crucible experience where you are beginning to doubt whether you have the right answers or not. So you need that perspective. So building those trusting relationships, reaching out to colleagues, having a network of colleagues that you can rely upon and excuse me, that's one of the values of ICMA. You know, having your colleagues in ICMA who know about the kinds of things you're dealing with, have maybe been through a similar kind of experience themselves and can share with you how they got through it. ICMA has a great network of people that can provide you with that feedback that's so important in our professional growth and development. So let me ask you this. So in those moments when you had these challenges, these crucible experiences, what values or principles did you have to rely on in order to sort of work through those things? What are the things that you just had to keep reminding yourself? I have to be true to myself and I have to stick to this in order to deal with that. Ashley, what do you have?
Well, actually one of the things that helped guide me kept me focused was the ICMA ethics, the rules of ethics that, you know. Mm-hmm. I printed that out and I kept that beside my computer and I would look at that every day and think, these are the ethics and principles of our profession and this is what I need to keep in mind as I move forward. Because what has always been most important to me is for people to have faith in their local government. and never wanted to do anything that would undermine the faith of the people in that community. So I was very careful about my words, my actions. I was dealing again with a lot of just nasty politics, personal attacks, professional attacks, just being attacked in public meetings. And so it was, you know, it required, you know, a great deal of composure and you know, just an ability to not lash out, an ability to just contain that and try to remain professional and neutral, to not be vengeful towards people. So my professional reputation, the reputation of the community, those were the two things that really kept me balanced and focused on doing the right thing and doing the job at hand.
What about you, Chief? What values or principles did you rely on?
I relied on a lot of things that were given to me as a child. And of course, this honesty, my ethics, being determined, setting goals, working hard, being a hard worker. And I think that, you know, through the majority of my career, I really had to stand on a lot of my values that were given to me as a child to make it through. You know, I mentioned earlier that now, you know, things are great. I have a lot of support in the city of Decatur. I get a lot of guidance, mentoring, and it wasn't like that prior to that. Mm-hmm. So those first years were very challenging because I wasn't used to, although, you know, I had to operate as a team my entire life, having seven siblings, I didn't have a choice then. And then when I began my journey in the fire service, initially it was like, you know, there were all of these little silos and it wasn't really a team effort, although we were all working towards the same goal. But then when I got to Decatur, it was like a whole different world. And I realized that, you know, this is what I have been working for all of my life, is to be in an environment that was so accepting of who I was. You know, it didn't matter that I was African American. It didn't matter that I was a female. You know, I did not have to compromise, or even, I don't think I can recall a time where I had to say, oh, should I do this or should I do that? You know, because, you know, like I said, you know, I feel like, and I know, you know, when I'm in my city and my environment, I'm in a bubble, because I know that when I get outside, it's not really like that. And so I have not really had to really look back and say, oh, I know that I was raised this way and I know I should do this. I don't have to think hard about it anymore. Mm-hmm. Where before I did, I had to say, okay, is this job really for me? Because I'm not willing to do that and compromise my values and the things that I was raised and how my mother and my father, what they taught me. I haven't had to do that in the last 7.5 years. Mm-hmm. Where before, it was questionable, because I had to say, is this job really for me? You know, I always aspired to be a fire chief, but as a deputy chief, I was like, I don't think so.
So you mentioned something about focusing on your goals. So how important do the three of you feel that refocusing about what your next goal is, to get beyond that crucible experience, that challenge, how important has that been for you to have that reset when you face a challenge and you have to get through it? And at the end, or when you get through it, it can, you know, keep you, you know, it can leave you exhausted. But how do you reset, re-energize, and refocus on the goals that you've got to set for yourself?
So for me, choosing to do the right thing in Madeira Beach, regardless of whether it was going to cost me my job, I knew nothing could be worse than what I had just gone through. So it was like, you know what, I'm going to do the right thing, because that's how I know to do it. And I'm better. Mm-hmm. I'm better than that. And so that takes, you kind of have to be fearless, I think. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. But so there was, as I said earlier, that moment of just kind of, you know, you're in the zone, you're doing what you have to do, because if you think beyond that right now, you'll just, you know, your black brain will explode. But for me, the reset was actually Clearwater, and the timing for me was mid-career. You know, are you really going to continue to do this? What are you going to do? And it allowed me to really take that pause, carve out that time to think about, okay, well, what are you going to do for the next 20 plus years or whatever it is? So I think all of your experiences to date, you know, come into play in that respect. But I also believe that you have to be very intentional about the choice you make. And again, even though we know the plan may not work, you constantly have to be thinking about one, be thinking about, I mean, because otherwise, what are you doing to yourself, you know? I mean, and some of those goals are personal, and some of those goals are professional, and hopefully those two aren't incompatible. So,
exactly.
You know, right? I mean, it's you know, choosing. The other thing that I would just say about the goal piece is I actually try to just do things that are accomplishable, right? So, and that changes as we age. I mean, I used to think I was going to hike the entire Appalachian Trail. I now know that's never going to happen.
Goals have to be realistic.
They do.
And achievable. And,
but you know what I can do is I absolutely can hike portions of it, right?
Right.
So, yes, it's all about modifying and adjusting as the journey goes on, and being realistic, I think. But be true to yourself, too.
So something you mentioned in your comment about being fearless. So through these processes that you've been through, these crucible experiences and achieving perspective and all that, was there any point at which fear and doubt really just consumed you, that you, it made you take pause? And if so, How did you deal with that doubt and fear? And I see Ashley nodding her head, so why don't you start, Ash?
I don't know if I have an answer on the top of my tongue. I'm just, there definitely were times when fear and doubt consumed me. I was afraid that I would lose my job. I was afraid that my professional reputation would be destroyed. I was afraid that I'd be, quote, a failure, whether that would be in my own eyes or in other people's. How did I overcome the fear and the doubt?
Mm-hmm.
I think I did it through a number of strategies. One was focusing on the goals, because mm-hmm. you know, I knew for one thing, one of the things that we were doing was I oversaw the transition of volunteer departments to a combined department that reported to the county administrator's office. And I don't know if any of you have worked with volunteer fire departments, mm-hmm. but combining 10 volunteer departments into one that reports to the administrator, it was quite a task. Mm-hmm. But it was something I knew was the right thing to do. I knew that when we did that, that we would improve the ISO rating, and that it would so dramatically improve the quality of life for people in the county, not just for the citizens and the businesses, but also for the firefighters themselves, that they would have better training and better resources. So having that in mind, knowing that that was where we were going, it really inspired me to just overcome that. It overshadowed the fear and the doubt, knowing that I had a task to do. It was going to be important. It was going to be fantastic if we did it. So that was part of it. But the relationships, you know, that was another huge part of overcoming the fear and the doubt. And really, being appointed to the Task Force on Women, the ICMA Task Force on Women, mm-hmm. was a critical part of my professional development, because I finally met people who were like me, who experienced the same challenges that I faced. And, you know, for the first time in my career, I felt like I belonged in the profession, you know. So having that support from that group, and they were men and women, it wasn't just women, it was men as well. And then also developing within my own self, there's a poem by Louise Gluck that's at the end of the poem. It says, there was in the center of my life there came a great fountain. And so that's what I realized, that I needed to develop my own core of peace, a place where just a center of strength that I could draw from and go forth. And I did that in a number of ways. I hired a great life coach, for one thing.
Oh, really?
But I also built on, and I always thought that was hokey. I was like, life coach, you have life coach.
coach. But I did find one who was amazing, and she's really helped me process a lot of things and give perspective. But also develop those relationships with other colleagues, and developed just my own sense of who I am. And that's, you know, that has helped tremendously. What do I want to do? What do I want to stand for? And having that solid core, that inner fountain that you can draw from, that was what can keep you going.
What about you?
So I face many fears. Initially it was being appointed the third female African American fire chief in the U.S. When I realized that, you know, I held that title, my fear was really failing. Because I felt like all the eyes were on me, and I've always been told throughout my career that the life of a fire chief is 5 years. So I was like, okay, so what am I going to do? 5 years, is it just going to go downhill from there? So my fear was always, you know, I have to not embarrass myself, not embarrass my family, not embarrass the kids that are looking at me, and you know, the role model that I am, that has always been a fear for me. I've set personal goals, I've set professional goals, and they're kind of, for me, it's been kind of easy because I've always been focused. But, you know, I get my energy from the network. I have weekly meetings with my supervisors to give me energy. I'm a part of organizations, that's where I get my energy and my empowerment from, to keep going and overcome those fears that I have of, you know, one day, oh, it's going to all come to an end, and you're going to be on TV like, oh, she made it, but uh-uh.
So, you know, being the first, I'm sure for all of you in your positions at one time or another, given our profession, that you've been the first. I myself have been the first woman and the first person of color in every job I've ever had, every single job. And that in itself is a real challenge, because you don't want to fail. You feel like everybody's looking at you and waiting for you to fail. So did you find that was the motivation not to fail, because you wanted to prove people wrong? And if so, What did you learn out of being the first in that position?
Well, I think that I don't think I focused so much on it, but I think that was the motivation for me, is to prove a lot of people wrong. Coming into the fire service, first of all, as a female, I'm 5'1". You know, they had to get a special seat for me to drive the back of the fire truck, all of that stuff, you know. It was just motivation for me to be better or be more than what people thought or viewed me as. Mm-hmm. So it was really motivation for me. I tried not to focus on it, but I just thought about, oh, you know, now I have a lot more siblings and, you know, I have to beat all of them out, so I'm going to do it.
What about for you, Ash?
I was the first female in every job I've held. So I definitely wanted to prove that I could do it, that if I did fail, it wouldn't be because, you know, because of my gender. And I was very conscious, of that. But even more so, what started happening throughout my career is that women in my organization started coming to me and saying, "You inspire me. You know, I see you in a leadership role. I see you succeeding. And that's inspiring me to go on and to be braver and to take more risk and, you know, to think that I can do better." And so that it was a little pressure, you know, but it also was very inspiring. And it really just gave me motivation to do better, to do as well as I could, and to serve as a leader in that capacity.
What about you, Jill?
Yeah, same thing. First female in all my positions until Clearwater. Clearwater had had a really good assistant who had sort of already laid the groundwork in that organization. So that, again, probably is the reason why I've done done so well and feel so good about working there, right? But yeah, no, so I think for me, I just have this little thing that in my head is that, you know, failure is not an option. And I think that's from Apollo 13, I can't remember, but we'll say it was. So I think, though, for me, it is really back to, I think early on it was just kind of stupidity because I didn't realize that you didn't just take the promotion and keep going. You know, I mean, I didn't really think about it. It was kind of like, oh, I'm working hard, I'm doing good, it's all good. So, yeah, but I think the motivation that comes with the responsibility, particularly as we become more of the mentors, and I'm trying to really embrace that role, I think that hopefully we have been able to, all of us have been able to do things that make it easier for the next, regardless of race, gender, any of those things. So yeah, I think it's about just being true and keep going, you know, and just, that's it, just keep going.
So one last question before we have a little bit of conversation in the groups has to do with the changing demographics that we're seeing in our communities, across the entire country, and how it's going to shift even more in the next 10 years, the next 20 years. You look out at this audience, and it's very different than an audience you would have seen 10 years ago. So for you as leaders in your organizations, how do you deal with those changing demographics in your communities, the need to provide diverse organizations, because we know that diverse organizations, excuse me, and gender-balanced organizations, pardon me, I'm trying to get through a cold, that they make better decisions. More perspectives are better than a single perspective. So how do you deal with that as a leader in your organizations? Jill, why don't you start out?
Well, one of the things I would share is that
so we are working really hard at the city of Clearwater to pay attention, to be attentive to the generational change, the diverse composition of our workforce, thinking about what we in ICMA like to call the next generation. I think that one of the things I will just quickly share with you that I do is I'm a mouthpiece for those things being important to us, that we do need to think about those portions of our community and the diversity and the complexity that it brings to our work. And, you know, again, here it's like, you know, most of my career, these weren't things you talked about, right? I mean, it just wasn't something that organizations really even commented on. And it was always kind of like this unspoken sort of, you know, and depending on the organization, it could be kind of the elephant in the room that nobody's talking about. So I'm actually really pleased that we're having the conversations. I think that in and of itself is progress. I think you have people like myself who has brought the Florida City County Management Association through some work that I've been doing with great people down in Florida. We adopted our first inclusion, diversity and inclusion statement as a state association. And we're doing a lot of outreach in that capacity. We're doing a session in June on the ethics of diversity, why having diverse teams is the ethical thing to do as local government managers. So I think there's a lot going on there. I also just beta tested back in January. We have an employee here who is with us there, but we just did a beta test of these games, the diversity games. One of them is Fear Factor. And, you know, for everybody feeling very comfortable to say something you're afraid of, right? Heights, snakes, planes, spiders, you know, quicksand, whatever it is. But people who have things that they fear that they don't want to share, or they're afraid because of something they can't change, the color of their skin, you know, their ethnicity, their religion, whatever it is. So, you know, we're just trying to be very open, talk about it a lot. We're being very intentional about having community liaison pieces in place with different populations, be that our homeless. We're doing a lot of homeless outreach. We're doing a lot of Hispanic liaison outreach in our community. We've got a great relationship in our traditional African American community. So, yeah, for me, I think it's just great that we're talking about it.
What about for you, Ashley?
I agree. I think just having the conversation and awareness about diversity is important. And one of the things that I've tried to do is just actively recruit. You know, so knowing that we were going to have someone retiring soon, you know, actively recruiting, thinking about, okay, what type of person would be good in this position? Maybe better to have a younger person. Maybe better to have a woman. Maybe better to have a man. You know, just thinking about how we can balance out our team. Mm-hmm. So also looking for people to champion. You know, thinking about looking at someone who may not have been given opportunities mm-hmm. before. And then, you know, reaching out to them and championing them, you know, in their career. So, because one of the things, I spoke at College of Charleston last week, and a lot of the students asked, they said, how do I stand out, you know, because I have no experience, mm-hmm. coming out of school. How do I stand out? How do I make my resume really jump out at you? And I said, well, you know, I'll be honest with you. There's only so much you can do on paper. There's only so much you can do on a resume. But what you can do is network. And you can know people, because every job I've ever gotten was because of somewhat a connection, you know. Mm-hmm. And but if these younger people, if they don't have those connections, if they don't know someone who can help them and really champion them in their career, then you know, then they're a little bit lost, and they do get lost in that sea of resumes as we're going through the job applications.
So, Chief, what about for you? I mean, we all know that the fire service has been diversity challenged forever. So, how do you look at that? And particularly because I understand that you've got a very diverse command staff. So tell us about that.
Yeah, so for so long, I would just say here recently, diversity has really been a bad word in the fire service. The fire service, we think that we have arrived now that we can talk about diversity. Not that we're doing a whole lot about it, because remember, 300,000, 7,000 women. We talk about it now, but we're not really doing a whole lot. But, you know,
it takes that intentionality that Jill was talking about,
absolutely,
and that I always talk about.
Absolutely. But, you know, in my community, we talk about diversity. I don't think we necessarily hire, say, okay, we need a diverse workforce, so we know we need to hire X amount of, you know, people with this religious background, X amount of women or X amount of men. We don't really do that, but we make sure we put the right people in the right positions, and we have fair processes. Mm-hmm. And as a result of that, we have a diverse department. I am proud to say that we are the only department in the country to have three women running the fire department. So, and it really wasn't a deliberate action. Mm-hmm. Again, we have fair processes, and we put the right people in the right places. And a lot that has happened with the fire service is, you know, you're promoted based on the relationships. You know, oh, his dad was a fire chief, so, you know, hey, we're gonna groom him, and, you know, we don't do that in the city of Decatur. You know, we have very, very fair processes. And one thing that I really didn't understand when I first got there, because, you know, Peggy and I had a conversation about, you know, recruitment and our process to become a firefighter. And she was like, you know, there will be no physical agility test to enter as a firefighter. I'm like, ooh, okay. But, you know,
that is a huge shift.
Absolutely.
A huge shift.
Absolutely. And I did not understand that before. But really, when I look at it, and I tell my colleagues all the time when they say, hey, you know, how do I get that diverse group? You have to remove those barriers. Mm-hmm. And when I look at it, that is a barrier. Of course, you need some upper body strength to be a firefighter. And you can't be claustrophobic. But everything else, it's learned. It's a learned task. Mm-hmm. And you have to, if you really want a diverse workforce, you have to remove the barriers, and not everybody is willing to do that.
And that, I think, is a key point. And it goes back to intentionality. We can talk about diversity and inclusiveness in our organizations. Mm-hmm. We can talk about it all the time. But if we don't take intentional steps to break down barriers, to cast a wide net when we're recruiting people, then we're not really being intentional in our efforts to create those diverse and inclusive organizations. And I really do believe, and you know, the body of research says that organizations that are diverse, that are gender balanced, and diverse in a lot of ways, not just race and
right.
ethnicity, but age, you know, broadly diverse, because we need those broad perspectives to reflect the communities that we are now serving that are changing so dramatically, and having that younger generation, the millennial perspective represented at the table, and having the whole full diversity of our communities is so important when we're developing policy recommendations in our community. So it's about intentionality and really putting action to the words when we talk about it. So we want to sort of wind down the session now, because we're running up against lunchtime, I realize that. And we've asked the panelists to offer us one career tip that they want to pass on to you as something that has been really important for them in their career. So we're going to start with the chief.
So it's really hard to just give one, but I would say be true to yourself, be in control of your destiny, and have patience.
Think of something else. I'll talk for a while. Risk-taking is a muscle. It is a muscle you have to flex, and you have to build just like any other muscle in order to make it strong and to make it something that's easy to do. If you had told me a year ago that I would leave city county management and be working for a nonprofit in Lake City, I would say, you're crazy. And it took a long time for me to decide to take the job, because my identity of myself was so intertwined with my title and my role in that organization in the county. And I had such a hard time letting go of it. Who will I be if I leave this job? You know, city county management is what I do. But what I really didn't realize is that what I was telling myself is, this is who I am. And it isn't who you are, it is what you do. Mm-hmm. And that's something that Pat mentioned earlier, that, you know, who you are is your skill set and your values and your ethics and your experience, and that's what you take with you. So I would say flex that risk-taking muscle as much as you possibly can, because there are rewards. I honestly felt like I was jumping off a cliff when I took that job. But I will tell you this from experience: if you do jump off the cliff, you will sprout wings and you will fly, okay? And I'll leave you with one more thing, because I just learned this and I thought it was really fun. So I've been trying to learn Italian for the past year, and I came across the best idiom the other day. It's conosco I miei polli. And what the literal translation is, I know my chickens. But what it means is, I know what I'm doing. I know what I'm getting into. I know what I'm talking about. And so, you know your chickens. You know what's in your heart. You know what you want. So trust that.
And I would add to that, based on what you said, one of my favorite Zen sayings is, take the leap, the net will appear.
Really wish I had something catchy and inspirational to share with you in Italian or in Zen. I got nothing. But to the same point, I think I learned something recently in totally different context, something that I'm doing for myself, and the lesson is about defeatist talk. And so my tip is, love the person you see in the mirror. If you wouldn't talk to other people the way you talk to yourself in your head, stop it. And I think that's true not only in early career, mid-career, but late career, but just in life. Love the person you see in the mirror and take care of yourself.
So I had hoped earlier to be able to project this quote up on the wall from the Leadership Challenge. And mainly I wanted to just have it up there during the session. It was a little pushback, so you may not have seen it, because I think it really underscores what we've tried to do in this session today to help you to understand. And it's from The Leadership Challenge, a book by Kuzes and Posner. And the quote is, "The mastery of the art of leadership comes with the mastery of self. Ultimately, leadership is a process of self-development. And that's what we've been talking about today. Becoming a resilient leader is not something that happens overnight. It's not something you are born with. No matter how great you are in school, no matter how well you do on the job, the art of leadership, the mastery of it, is not something you'll learn all at one time. It is a process, and it is a process that you develop as a result of conversations like this, of learning from other people, of having people share their experiences with you, and taking that in for yourself. Because I guarantee somewhere down the line, in your own journeys, something will come back to you about something you've heard from great speakers like this, from people that you meet along the way in your organizations, at conferences, wherever. So that's what the art of leadership and mastering it is about. It's that self-process, that self-awareness. I want to conclude the session today by thanking all of my panelists. Great session, even better than I envisioned it. But I also want to acknowledge that this session was brought to you in collaboration with Women Leading Government. And I want to put in a little push for Women Leading Government because, as you can see, I am a member of Women Leading Government, so I'm representing them today. Women Leading Government is an initiative that was started back in 2006 in California by the Cal ICMA Preparing the Next Generation Committee. We wanted to help to advance women and people of color, others in the profession, emerging leaders in our profession, and to help them with professional development. And so a group of female managers in California, city, county managers, special district managers, they formed an organization called Women Leading Government. And the purpose was to provide role models where there were none in non-traditional roles for women to advance in the profession, and to explore the opportunities for people, men and women, who are emerging leaders to come into public service and see that you can aspire to be someone because you can see people doing the things that you aspire to do. And so Women Leading Government has grown extensively in California, but now we've taken our mission on the road. And we have been forming Women Leading Government organizations in states across the country. In fact, Ashley was the one who helped organize Women Leading Government in South Carolina. So we are working together with state associations to create women in leading government organizations in other places as a means to help advance women in our profession, to expand diversity and inclusion, and to really do that with intentionality. So I want to close with one last my little tip. So one of the things that I really gain inspiration from is hearing what other people have to say about things. And so I highlight quotes that have been really important and meaningful to me. I also believe that pushing through and becoming a resilient leader, pushing through crucible experiences, really requires us to deal with the doubts and fears that we talked about. So I have this little book, and it's called Do One Thing Every Day That Scares You. And as you can see, I have a lot of pages that I have highlighted for myself because these are sayings that remind me every single day about what it is to do the job that we do in public service. And personally, what it means to work on mastering leadership and self-development. And this particular quote is actually from a politician who I tend never to quote, but it was such an important one that I thought that I would share this with you in closing. And it is a quote from Cory Booker, who is a U.S. senator from New Jersey. So Senator Booker said this: "You cannot find what you do not seek. You cannot grasp when you do not reach. Your dreams won't come up to your front door. You've got to take a leap if you want to soar." And that's what being a leader is all about, and being a resilient leader means continuing to strive, continuing to push through the soar in spite of all the obstacles. I want to thank you all for being here today.
I hope that we've shared a few nuggets with you that you'll take along on your journeys. And I look forward to talking with many of you throughout the rest of the summit. So thank you very much.